All right, welcome everyone to the kickoff of our summer webinar series. For those who are just joining us, if this is your first time on one of our webinars, we do have everybody muted and your screen is recorded or screen is hidden just so that we can put full attention and focus on our presenter for today. If you do have questions though, we're gonna let Dr. Van Vliet speak for about 40 minutes and then he has agreed to answer some questions. He's gonna leave some time there at the end. So I think there's gonna be a lot of interest in this conversation. So we wanted to leave time for you guys to ask those questions. So we've got Dale Strickler's on with us as well. He'll be leading the Q&A portion. So if you do have questions, there's a Q&A portion at the bottom of your screen where you can type those in. Otherwise, there is the chat feature if you want to put them in there as well. So with that, we're really excited to have Dr. Stephan Van Vliet with us. He's in Utah, is that correct?
That's correct, Logan, Utah.
So he's probably feeling the same heat we are here in Nebraska, but today we're going to talk about nutrient density in grass-fed meat and milk. This is something that a lot of people are, you know, interested in as we go to more grass-fed livestock, is looking at, is there actually any benefits to this? We know that there is for the soil, but we wanted to bring in the human health side of things. And so I'm really excited for this topic. Dr. Stephan Van Vliet is a nutrition scientist with metabolomics expertise in the Center for Human Nutrition Studies at Utah State University. And before I even continue, I'm going to butcher a lot of these terms because I am I'm not a very good linguist, so I apologize. But Dr. Van Vliet has earned his PhD in kinesiology as an ESPEN fellow from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign and received training at the Washington University in St. Louis School of Medicine and Duke University School of Medicine. His research is performed at the nexus of agriculture and human health. He routinely collaborates with farmers, ecologists, and agricultural scientists to study the critical linkages between agriculture production methods, the nutrient density of food, and human health. His work has been published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, Scientific Reports, the Journal of Nutrition, and the Journal of Physiology. That is quite the reputation you bring, the accolades. So we're really excited. Thank you so much for the time that you've dedicated to educate our producers here on this topic.
Thank you so much for that lovely introduction, Noah, and thank you everyone for attending my webinar, and thank you for being here. I want to present some ongoing work on our work that deals with agricultural production systems, nutrient density, and human health. Our emerging data from our group and also others certainly indicates that what you feed an animal or how you raise an animal has a substantial impact on the nutrients that are found in the meat and milk. We've also been studying phytochemicals. Now you may ask, what is a phytochemical? And I will go into that, but those are plant compounds that are actually transferred from the forage into the meat and milk an animal and could potentially impact the health of the animal. And potentially also our health. So that's what we'll go over today. So some disclosures, current and recent partnerships with the USDA NIFA-SER, USDA ARS, Turner Institute of Eco-Agriculture, the Bio-Nutrient Institute, and the Green Acres Foundation, who have made this work possible. So I'll present the data from those studies, and you can also find my conflict of interest policy regarding the food industry. So on today's agenda is, first of all, a brief introduction on understanding the relationship amongst plant, animal, and human health. We often hear that, and even when we pull in the soil, that healthy soils equals healthy plants, equals healthy animals, equals healthy humans. While this may intuitively make sense and sounds logical, there has been historically a lack of data that studies those critical linkages amongst that continuum. So we've been doing work in that area where we're trying to compare health along that continuum and seeing do more sustainable production practices indeed lead to healthier animals and healthier humans. In part two, we'll look at the impact of grazing practices on nutrient density and animal health in North American ruminants. We've done work in cattle, in bison, both looking at their meat, and then we've also done some work in milk that I'll present. And I do want to highlight, when we're talking about nutrient density and animal health, as you can imagine, the two are very much connected with each other. We can obtain nutrients from the compounds that are found in animal sourced foods, but the animal, first and foremost, that obtains this from the forage, uses the compounds to stimulate their own health. So there's this tight connection between nutrient density and animal health, as we'll see in this presentation. And I'll leave plenty of time for Q&A in the case of any questions. So understanding relationships amongst plant, animal, and human health. Something that many farmers dub regenerative systems are systems that can improve the health of the soil, improve the health of plants, and has a trickle-down effect to animal health and the human metabolome, human health. So we have current ongoing work through USDA and IFA-SER, as well as the Turner Foundation, which has supported our work on bison and the Dixon Water Foundation. We're also working with the Bionutrient Institute on a bigger project where we're looking at beef nutrient density across 250 farms in the US, which I'll go into as well. But the main question here is that, what are we interested in? Well, we're interested in agroecology. And agroecology is just a sort of scientific term to describe nature-based farming, or trying to mimic natural systems within farming systems. It is also sort of a broader idea that we just don't look at health from a purely physical standpoint, but also what does that mean for farmer well-being, for local communities, food security, and things like that. So it's a sort of a holistic approach, agroecology. Now, agroecology in many ways has to do with nutrient cycles. In our current farming systems, as many of you know, we have simplified our systems greatly to monocultures of plants or animals, typically grow one crop. The other farmer raises one animal, and there's also very little integration between the two. Now, with rising fossil fuel prices and rising input prices, I was definitely happy to see when I recently, or late last year, drove to Nebraska and Iowa, that there was a lot of cattle actually grazing corn residue and corn stalks. So that was great to see. And we're also working with farmers with multi-species livestock system, of course, where that is possible. It's not possible across the US, but also with multi-cropping systems. We know these have benefits. And by closing nutrient cycles, which is what we talked about in the paper that we published in the Journal of Animal Science, we can address agroecological and socioeconomic issues, potentially human health, food security, and a reduction in fossil fuel inputs by using these systems and merging the two. Related to that, there's also an increased consumer and farmer interest in pasture-raised meat and milk. The grass-fed beef market, as you can see here on the left, has been doubling every year and is reaching high levels of sales. The same with the global organic dairy market, which is projected to be triple what it was in 2018 by 2026. Now, I must admit that, and as you all know, not all grass-fed beef or organic dairy is per se produced using agroecological methods, or what people would describe as regenerative farming, which is systems that aim to improve soil health, plant diversity, climate resilience, and community health. But it does indicate that there's this increased interest in pasture-raised meat and milk, which are fueled by the environmental and health concerns of particularly animal-sourced foods. Now, and indeed, by focusing on reducing inputs such as water, fertilizer, concentrate feeds, and herbicides, by raising multiple species of livestock on the first cover crops or perennial plants, farmers are increasingly implementing pasture-based systems that can improve soil health and plant biodiversity. But then what we're going into now, does that also have a trickle-down effect to nutrient density? So for our work, we do a lot of on-farm sample collection. So I'm trained as a muscle physiologist or human nutrition scientist. So we do a lot of randomized controlled trials, feeding people different foods in our lab. But I'm also privileged that I get to spend time with farmers, and which is a nice break from the lab. So the data I'll present here is from data that we gathered over the last grazing season and analyzed earlier this year. So we're collecting soil samples, forage samples, and meat samples. So here is an example of the sample collection. And we are collecting samples from pastures, from animals that are finished on pasture. And what we did in our USDA project, we also found the nearest cornfield that we could find. Usually they were only 1 mile apart because corn is grown almost everywhere across the US. And we took soil samples from both. The cornfield was a model of what is used in livestock feed. So in the feedlot system, obviously it goes into the commodity market, so it might up in bioethanol as well. But as you can see here, this is Dr. Alan Franz Luber, a soil scientist who worked with us on these projects, collecting soil samples and looking at soil health. Now, the next part that we do is we also collect plant samples because we are interested in seeing what's in the feed that the animals received or the pasture that they grazed and overlaying it with the meat to see if there is a relationship between the nutrients in the feed and what ends up in the meat, because the saying you are what you eat definitely also holds true in animals. So we have grain-fed samples, grass-fed samples, both in terms of forage and meat. And then we use a technique that is called metabolomics. So I will talk a little bit about that so you have an idea of what we are presenting here. And you can really use any biological sample for metabolomics analysis. So metabolomics analysis, starting with a soil, plant, or a food sample, or even a human sample, is we take these samples into the lab, we process them, and we run them through a mass spec. Now, what a mass spec can do is every compound has a unique molecular mass or a unique weight. And by having standards that we know that are that compound, we can identify these compounds. So we might inject a sample for an hour into this piece of equipment. And then we end up identifying about 500 to 1,000 metabolites or compounds in the biological sample. As you can imagine, it's an overwhelming amount of data that we get. So after we've locked ourselves up in a basement for 3 weeks analyzing this data, we have this spread out by, for instance, phenols, terpenes, amino acids, fatty acids. So we cluster these metabolites into nutrient classes. And if we do these analysis on forage samples, on meat samples, and on human samples, then we end up with studying health along this plant-animal human health continuum, getting after the question, does increased plant health equal animal health equal human health? And with metabolomics, we go far beyond, especially if we use this for food, we go far beyond just proteins and fats, which has been the predominant focus of grass-fed and grain-fed meat and milk. And I think is a reason why most people consider that the only difference is omega-3s, because that is what has been historically looked at. But foods in their natural state contain thousands of nutrients. So if you look at a broader array of nutrients, which is what we're doing in metabolomics, you get a much deeper insight into the complexity of foods and all the compounds that are in it and how that relates to different production practices. So we have 13 nutrients that appear on our nutrition facts panel. So if I pick up a package of food or beef, you might see protein, you might see fat, and a handful of vitamins and minerals. If I go onto the USDA database, then there's about 150 components. But they form the basis of our nutritional understanding and dietary guidelines and policies. And that's why we often think of, you know, in terms of broad terms like protein or saturated fat. But the food matrix contains thousands of compounds, individual saturated fatty acids, individual amino acids, individual phytochemicals that can impact human health, that impact the human metabolome. And the nutrigenome, which is basically nutrient-related gene expression. So by overlaying the food metabolome with the human metabolome, we're connecting the presence of these compounds in food and how they impact human health and disease-related to gene expression. And it allows us to better understand the impacts of foods and dietary patterns on human health. And more importantly, it allows us to do so with an appreciation of the complexity of foods. because obviously we do not consume nutrients like protein, we consume foods. Now, before I go into this, I do want to explain to you what a metabolite is. So we are measuring metabolites, which are small molecules that we obtain from the breakdown of foods, drugs, chemicals, or our own tissues. This is also why I said earlier is that these metabolites that are found within the animal, they are there to stimulate or improve their metabolism that they have obtained from the forage. But many of these can serve as nutrients to us. But amino acids, they come from muscle tissue, but we also get those from food sources, particularly protein-rich food sources. Carotenoids, a phytochemical, we obtain from carrots, but also from onions and other foods. But there is also, obviously, this can also come from within the tissue. Now, I must say that phytochemicals is not something that that we produce ourselves, but we obtain those from food sources. But certain fatty acids can come from adipose tissue or a dietary source. So having said that about the metabolites, they are important for the health of humans, plants, and we can obtain, when obtained from foods, these compounds, these metabolites, which many of them are nutrients, they can be used to stimulate our health and meet our nutritional requirements. So the data that I want to present now was to determine the differences in metabolomes, so in these metabolites, these 500-600 compounds that we get from our analysis, in the metabolomes of North American ruminants. So in this project, we profile both bison and beef from a grass-fed system and a grain-finished system. The grain-finished system, in terms of beef, was obtained from a Midwest feedlot in South Dakota with four-month finishing on corn-based rations, and the animals were consuming about 80-85% corn. The grass-finished beef was obtained from southern Idaho, Olive Spring Ranch, where the cattle graze native rangelands and actually mountain pastures, which are very biodiverse. So the animals have access to about 200 plants over the grazing season. In our bison project, we had something similar like that, but it was even further controlled in the sense that this was a herd of bison that were in the McGinley Ranch, one of the Turner ranches in Nebraska. It was a big herd. Then half the herd stayed on pasture and continued to graze native rangelands until October. And then the grain-finished bison, they were put in confinement in a pen where they had free choice access to hay and corn and for 4 months. Now, I must say that bison typically are provided with a bit more space than cattle because bison are obviously semi-wild and they don't do as well in confinement, but they were also consuming corn. So we were interested in seeing how common finishing systems, grass-fed or grain-fed in bison and beef impacted their nutritional composition. And this is our statistical summary and a sort of a high-level overview of the data. And I want to zoom in on the total biochemical. So we identified 578 unique compounds in the grain-fed and grass-fed beef. We identified 538 unique compounds in bison. I didn't present the data here, but we also have another 1,000 lipid compounds that we detected in each. So overall, 1,500 compounds, which is a very in-depth analysis. I would argue one of the most in-depth to date on beef and bison. Now, we often hear that there is no real difference between grass-fed and grain-fed apart from the omega-3 fatty acids. What our data suggests is that there are differences that go far beyond that, and I'll show you in a little bit all the data that we have, but just from a high-level overview, just for simply 4 months of finishing bison either on pasture or on grain, and they had the exact same farm that they were raised in, grazing the exact same pasture before they went into the feedlot. This ends up with a 52% difference in metabolite abundance after those 4 months, with a difference going far beyond omega-3 fatty acids. And we saw the same thing in our beef profiling study. So larger than previously appreciated. And I think that it's mainly just because people hadn't looked further than omega-3 fatty acids yet. Now, to give you a high-level overview of the data, and as you can imagine, we get these 500 components, and we've got to sort of distill this down into a level that we can understand and digest. So all these points here in gray are grain-finished beef. All these points here in green are grass-finished beef. And then on the other side, this is grass-finished bison and grain-finished bison. Now, if you have no knowledge on metabolomics, you can see here is that grass fat isn't grain fat and grain fat isn't grass fat. If they were indeed similar, then these gray points would overlap with the green points, and they do not. They cluster separately from each other, and there's clear separation between grain finishing and grass finishing. So now we will dive into what are some of these differences in terms of the nutrients. So part, which brings us to part two, the impact of grazing practices on nutrient density and animal health in North American ruminants. If we start with vitamins and cofactors, and I'll spend some time on this slide to explain to you what this all means and what this data is. So within the meat samples, and this is from cattle, we ran this metabolomics profile, 500-600 compounds. Many of these that come off of these analyses are vitamins and cofactors. Vitamin B3 metabolism, vitamin B5, vitamin C, tocopherols, and choline metabolism. The data is expressed as a fold difference between grass divided by grain. So niacin, which is the main form of vitamin B3 in foods, was 9.4-fold higher in grass-fed beef compared to grain-fed beef. Now, nicotinamide, which is higher in grain-fed beef, is a common supplemental form of B3 and only present in small amounts in nature, and it's commonly added to total mixed rations. So that is why this is higher in grain-fed beef. And it was about two times higher, whereas niacin, the main form of vitamin B3 in foods, was ninefold higher in the grass-finished animals, which is directly related to their feed. We found something similar in terms of vitamin C and tocopherols, which are vitamin E. They are best known for their antioxidant effects. Alpha tocopherol is abundant in vitamin E. Vitamin C is also found in fresh forages, and that was 1.6 to 3-fold higher. So as you can see, there's a more B vitamins and vitamin C and vitamin E accumulating in grass-fed beef, typically. But this may not always, I think one reason why this wasn't always appreciated in the past is if you distinguish between types of vitamin B3, which we did here, niacin, nicotinamide, and alpha tocopherol and gamma tocopherol. Gamma tocopherol is again a common supplemental form of vitamin E, and it's also found in grain. So I don't want to per se say one is better than the other. We know more about alpha tocopherol than we know about gamma tocopherol. Perhaps gamma tocopherol can have some unique benefits that alpha tocopherol doesn't have, though it is typically well accepted that alpha tocopherol has a higher bioavailability and impact on some of our health markers. So moving on to the next one, we saw here different differences in vitamins, typically a bit higher in grass-fed animals. If we look at the omega-3s, the omega-3s is something that most people are familiar with because it's well accepted that omega-3s are higher in grass-fed beef. This is what we found too. We found that DHA was 3-fold higher in grass-fed compared to grain fat. We found that EPA was about 10-fold higher, and alpha-linoleic acid, ALA, which is a plant precursor, was also 10-fold higher. And these are essential fatty acids that may lower the risk of getting various metabolic diseases. One critique I often hear, and I do want to sort of set that straight, is that people often think that, well, if you compare grass-fed beef to salmon, then grass-fed beef contains very little, and therefore it does not contribute meaningfully to our omega-3 status. Well, there have been about 5 to 7 randomized controlled trials that fed grass-fed beef that do find that after about 8 weeks of consumption, you see an increase in DHA and EPA within the blood of people and in their red blood cells, suggesting that despite these low amounts, it can contribute meaningfully to the omega-3 status, though I must admit, of course, and highlight that fish has more and will contribute more, but that is not to say that ruminant meats cannot also contribute to overall omega-3 status. Now, what about saturated fat? We often hear, indeed, saturated fat is something that should be avoided. But my question then always is, well, what types of saturated fatty acids are we talking about? Because that's also an important thing to note, and not to say that many in our diet could not benefit from reducing saturated fat, but the type of saturated fatty acid matters too. And this was really an aha moment when I saw this data. And in the end, of course, it makes total sense, but similar to the long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids, the omega-3 fatty acids, these very long-chain saturated fatty acids also become enriched in grass-fed beef. So if the polyunsaturated have more of those very long chains, then in retrospect, yeah, I could have expected that on saturated fat too, but I must admit that wasn't on my radar until I saw this data as well, and probably why this is not often talked about, because it was just not known. But what we found is that these long-chain saturated fatty acids are, several-fold higher in grass fat versus grain fat. What is interesting about this is that these long-chain saturated fatty acids in epidemiological research are actually associated with a decreased risk of cardiovascular disease, whereas perhaps some of the shorter chain fatty acids and the medium chain ones are associated with an increased risk. So again, it highlights that saturated fat isn't saturated fat, and that depending on what you feed the animal, you can shift the fatty acid profile of the beef in something that looks more helpful, at least on paper. Now, we don't know if, of course, eating grass-fed beef lowers your risk of cardiovascular disease. That's not what I'm saying at all. That needs to be more research done, but that these fatty acids also become enriched was not previously recognized by consumers and the scientific community. So this is interesting information. And one of the studies that we're doing now is a multi-week feeding trial. Well, if we give grass-fed beef to people, do we then also see some of these longer chain saturated fatty acids that in population-based studies are associated with a decreased risk of cardiovascular disease? Do we see those increasing in the blood of participants as well? Because that is what people are found, and well, if we have found in the past too, with omega-3 fatty acids. Then if we move on to the next slide, phytochemicals, which are plant-produced metabolites and health. Plants, they respond to sunlight, to moisture, to nutrients, to other plants, and they produce phytochemicals. Now, phytochemicals, they are potentially anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, antioxidant, and they can benefit the animal's health, but there are also these phytochemicals become enriched in the meat and milk of the animal, and they can represent another avenue by which we obtain phenolic metabolites. And perhaps in the past, people have always associated these with plant foods, and certainly they are higher when we directly consume plant foods, but there are various unique metabolites that we can obtain because the animal contains forage that you and I cannot consume. So it's a further avenue of getting some unique phytochemicals in our body and increase the overall phytochemical richness of our diet to potentially promote our health. So in this case, we will look at some of the bison data. The findings are largely similar in cattle. In cattle, they're even larger, which is, I think has to do with the fact that the bison had free choice access, so they could regulate their grain and hay intake and alfalfa intake somewhat, but they still consumed a lot of corn. But corn is typically a little bit less rich in phytochemicals than fresh forages, as I'll show you later on. So these plant phenolic compounds, when obtained from the forage, they are metabolized into various compounds that each could have unique health effects on both the animal and our bodies. And what we found was that many of these, hyperate is, for instance, a major well-known phytochemical, a phenolic, that is also a good indicator of the phenolic richness of the diet. We found these to be higher in the grass-fed animal. And this was nearly threefold higher, as you can see here. So green here means higher in the grass-fed animal. As you can see, many of these were higher in the grass-fed animals. And these are all phenolic metabolites that may broadly have sort of anti-inflammatory and antioxidant effects upon ingestion. What was very interesting though, and things are never black and white, is that these two compounds are very rich in alfalfa, and these were actually higher in the grain-fed animals. Now, that was not per se because of the grain, but that was because of the inclusion of alfalfa in their finishing ration. So certainly some feeding of alfalfa hay or other types of hay may rescue some of that phytochemical richness in that regard. And also points out that maybe, you know, during winter feeding, that certain types of hay could be beneficial. And one of the other things we're studying also now is sort of agri waste, which is waste from, you know, waste streams from cherry production or grape production, and which contain high amounts of phytochemicals that could potentially be used in animal agriculture to perhaps decrease our reliance on grains a little bit. Pasture grazing accumulates phytochemicals, and these are individual phytochemicals. Again, beta-carophyllene, alpha-cubobane. These are terpenes, and they are found exclusively or in higher amounts in grass-fed beef, and particularly when the animals are grazing biodiverse pasture. Again, we have to rely here on in vitro data that we know, but some of these terpenes, if you throw these on a petri dish in a cancer cell line, they may have anti-cancer effects or anti-inflammatory effects. Certainly, we must do a lot more work in humans to understand the impact on human health, but these are some of the potential bioactivities that these various compounds can have. Now, one of the questions I often get is, what happens to the phytochemical richness when animals are finished in feedlots? What if we give them, if we have a start with high amounts of phytochemicals before they go into the feedlots? Well, this work is nice work that was already done in the 1980s, the year I was born actually. And what the authors found was they looked at phytochemicals, specifically terpenes, in when the animals went from pasture here on day zero into a feedlot. And what happens to the phytochemical richness after 60 days, 90 days, and 120 days? There's the phytochemicals are cut in half after 60 days and about threefold lower than after 120 days, which is typically when the animals are slaughtered. And what's very interesting is that the magnitude of differences, or we have found that phytochemicals are about 2.5 to 3-fold higher in grass-fed animals compared to feedlot finished animals. And that is what these authors found too. There's about a 3-fold reduction in phytochemicals when the animal goes onto the feedlot, which makes us comfortable in the statement that this is absolutely related to the feed. And similar findings have been made in lamb too from a group in Italy. The direct relationship between phytochemicals in forage and meat and milk. We know in humans that about 50% what circulates in our blood or what we can find in our tissue is directly related to the foods that we eat. So the statement you are what you eat is about half true. In animals, it's not any different. Just another mammal, when you look at it from sort of a molecular sense. So I do want to zoom in on this. So on the y-axis, we see milk polyphenol content. And then on the x-axis is the forage polyphenol content. All the way up here is grass and pasture. More forage, more polyphenols in the forage equals more polyphenols in the milk. And again, it's about threefold higher than when that same grass and pasture is made into hay or in silage, whereas corn TMR is the lowest. So lowest amounts of polyphenols in corn-based TMR, resulting in the lowest amounts of polyphenols in milk. So there's this nice relationship, this direct relationship between what you feed an animal and the phytochemicals that you can subsequently find in the milk. And based on the literature and some of our initial findings that we're seeing too, if we have to give sort of a broad overview of what we see happening is that plant diversity seems to be really key when it comes to in terms of phytonutrient content, but also in terms of animal health. It allows the animal to somewhat self-select their diet, find the unique forages and compounds that are needed to optimize their health. And it also results in a sort of a broader array and higher amounts of phytonutrients to become accumulated in the meat and milk. So broadly speaking, a plant species diverse pasture versus a monoculture, which may be one or two dominant grasses, both can be labeled grass-fed when sold. But this contains substantially more phytochemicals than a monoculture does. And there's, of course, further nuances when it comes to overgrazing versus intensive rotational grazing. And these are things that we're now trying to find out in our beef nutrient density project, where we profile 250 farms. But typically, you find the lowest amounts in feedlot finished animals. And as many things as we're seeing in our data, there's not one way to roam. Biodiverse pasture seeding, but also cover crop grazing public rangelands, as we see here out west, when they are properly grazed, they all represent ways of getting a very diverse mixture of forages to be fed to the animal, which increases the phytochemical richness of meat and milk that broadly have anti-inflammatory and antioxidant effects. I do want to finish now with a few minutes talking about animal health. So we profile the meat of animals. I'm originally trained as a muscle biologist, or a physiologist in humans. We were doing, and are still do, we take muscle biopsies from people. We run metabolomics on it, and we get a good insight into the metabolic health of the human based on what we find in their muscle. Now, what I got to think of that is when we started to profile meat from another mammalian species, in this case, bison or beef, I got to think is like, well, we get a lot of this information about the health of the human from their muscle. What if we do similar analysis on the meat from animals on their muscle? Can we also find sort of a metabolic disease or metabolically healthy profile? And we were able to find that. So glycolysis is an indicator of glucose metabolism. And what was very interesting to see, and I won't go into all the details, but what you typically see in a phenotype of human metabolic disease or diabetes is that there is a worsening of fructose metabolism, mannitol metabolism, mannanose, and various glycolytic intermediates. I do want to say is that this data does not indicate that the grain-fed animals have diabetes. They typically do not develop that. It also per se doesn't mean that these animals have metabolic disease, but what our data does indicate that if you compare grass-fed animals to grain-fed animals, and the grass-fed animals shows a healthier metabolic phenotype, whereas the grain-fed animals start to show display some metabolic dysfunction. How this impacts human health down the line, I have no idea. We don't know yet. But comparatively, the grass-fed animals show a healthier glucose metabolism that is strikingly similar to a human that starts to develop early signs of metabolic dysfunction, whereas the grass-fed animals look surprisingly like an sort of endurance-trained athletic phenotype. We've taken biopsies from endurance-trained athletes, and they have an upregulation of these mitochondrial, these TCA cycle metabolites, much like we see in the grass-fed animals. So there's this connection that we're starting to see between animal health and nutrient density, and perhaps intuitively it makes sense, but it is nice that we actually see this in our data too. And this is bison data, but we saw the same thing in our beef data. Speaking of things related to that, advanced glycation end products may be something that you've heard about. We've looked at some of the good in meat, but now let's look at some of the potentially harmful compounds in meat. Though certainly, again, I want to highlight that overall diet quality and what you eat with meat may largely impact this. But that's a whole other discussion we can talk about for hours. Let's focus on the advanced glycation end products. Advanced glycation end products are one of the reasons why the International Agency Research on Cancer of the World Health Organization considers red meat a potential carcinogen. And I was quite surprised when we started to analyze this data, but in retrospect, again, it's one of those aha moments that totally makes sense. If you remember from the previous slide, the grain-fed bison had more glucose in their system and they had impaired glucose metabolism. These advanced glycation end products are actually in part produced from glucose. So if the animal has more glucose that is not metabolizing properly, it may result in higher advanced glycation end products. So this is a very interesting finding, is that grass-fed meat actually has lower amounts of these advanced glycation end products. And they play an important role in the pathogenesis of cancer and diabetes and cardiovascular disease in humans. Again, cannot state that this is indicates that the animal had diabetes. That's not at all what this indicates, but comparing grass-fed to grain-fed, some of these harmful compounds are lower, and this may be related to the fact that there's less glucose in the animal. Moving on to oxidative stress markers in the animals. Again, something we can measure by looking at these 500-600 compounds in meat. So for simplicity sakes, some of those are indicative of nutrient density, others are indicative of animal health. But as I highlighted earlier, the two are, of course, very much, much connected with each other. But in this figure, uric acid, which found intracellularly, in the case of inflammation or oxidative stress, uric acid is converted to allantoic acid under the condition of inflammation. What we see here is more urate in the grass-fed animal, and less allantoic acid, as I mentioned, under oxidative stress. This is reduced to this. So by having less of this in the grass-fed animals, again, is an indicator that there was less oxidative stress in the grass-fed animal as compared to the grain-fed animal. So this is what we're seeing here too, less oxidative stress, a healthier animal. And then also further that, these are bile acids, and then they are related to also our gut, the gut microbiome. These two bile acids, which we actually detected metabolites of in the muscle, which was interesting of itself because I did not expect it, but others have found that typically these are higher in the feces of grass-fed animals, and these are bile acids with potential anti-inflammatory effects. So likely indicating that the grass-fed animals have a healthier gut microbiome. And we're following up these analyses now by doing it in the fecal matter of these cows. And I had a cow research assistant recently when we were collecting so many samples. Here you can see we're sampling the cow pie from this animal, collecting small amounts of fecal matter, which we are going to study the gut microbiome of the animal in, and seeing if some of the things we observe in the muscle translate to what we are seeing in the animal. With that, we come to some conclusions based on our initial data. What we find is that difference in meat from different production systems, their differences go well beyond the omega-3 fatty acids. 50 to 60% difference in abundance of compounds, purely based on how you finish the animal, can result in a 50% difference in the compounds that you find in the meat. So that is well beyond those omega-3 fatty acids, as we mentioned. Phytonutrients, a class that we've been interested in, especially because there's this direct transfer from the forage into the meat and the milk of the animal. Several of these phytochemicals, on paper at least, are anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, but their importance remains to be further studied. And we are doing randomized controlled trials now where we're feeding grass-fed beef and grass-fed milk to people and seeing how this impacts their health. One thing that was perhaps previously not recognized as much is grass-fed meat also accumulates more long-chain saturated fatty acids and various B vitamins, especially once you start distinguishing between the forms of B vitamins that are in there. They also contain less advanced glycation end products and homocysteine. Again, this relationship between a healthier animal and more nutrient-dense meat. And this is something that I think is important to take away, is that, of course, B plant sources, direct consumption of plant source. If I consume a carrot, then yeah, I'll get more beta carotene than when I consume animal source foods. But herbivores do consume plant species otherwise not consumed by humans, representing another dietary avenue by which additional unique phytochemicals are ingested. So it's a further way of increasing the phytochemical richness of our diet when we consume meat in combination with a wide variety of plant source foods. In our future directions, we are doing a post-meal study. We're comparing grass-fed beef, grain-fed beef, and a plant-based meat alternative. They're matched for protein. They are matched for fat. If we eat that, we can already detect many of these compounds from the meat into the blood and urine of people. So I've showed you this metabolomics profiling that we can do that on meat, which is what I presented to you here. But we do that on plasma samples and urine samples of humans too. If we overlay the two, do we see some of these compounds from grass-fed beef, grain-fed beef, and plant-based meat alternatives make its way into the blood of people? And does this give a different nutritional profile or postprandial profile of what circulates in our blood? Hoping to find that out and studying that and seeing if there is indeed a potential difference. We're also studying a range of beef production systems. We have now 30, 40 farms or so that we've profiled from, but we are working on a beef nutrient density project. So if you're interested in Googling this, beef nutrient density, we're still looking for some farmer partners and some additional funding, a sponsor farm or things like that. Just Google beef nutrient density project with the BioNutrient Institute. We're studying a range of beef production systems. Can we see this consistency in certain production systems that always produce the highest amounts of phytochemically rich beef and have the most beneficial omega-6-to-3 ratios? And what are these practices and what do they look like? The simple question that we're asking is, do more sustainable production practices also impact the nutrient density of beef? So we're taking soil, forage, and meat samples, study health along that continuum, and tagging on a randomized controlled trial with humans at the end. And we're also working on, and I'm particularly excited about this, we made this regenerative diet in work with the Green Acres Foundation, where we have all of our produce, meat, eggs, and milk that come from integrated systems. So similar, an integrated crop livestock system as displayed down here. We compare that to a conventional diet on markers of human health in a 7-week randomized controlled trial. We're having 40 people in that study. Very large study. We're providing them with all their food. They get grass-fed meat, milk, dairy, eggs, and produce that was grown in regenerative or agroecological ways. And we compare that to conventional to see indeed if there is an additional benefit of consuming that. Though I have no doubt that even when we put people on a sort of conventionally produced whole foods diet, that people will get healthier compared to a standard American diet. But we're seeing if there's additional benefits from consuming those foods from a regenerative system. And then finally, linking the fields of food production, nutrition, and population health. Sort of the bigger picture, why do we do this? Well, it is based on the idea that the health of the soils, plants, animals, and humans are related. And at least, we're making a tiny slice of the pie here. At least my particular interest is in diet and lifestyle, and do more agroecological production practices benefit human health. And with that, I'd like to acknowledge various people. I am the messenger, but none of this work was done alone. I have a lot of thanks to my collaborators who have worked with me on this, and a special shout out to the farmers too that we presented some of the data here from. And with that, I'll end my presentation and welcome any questions.
Cool. Well, thank you. That was awesome. I know one question I have, and we'll get to some of the questions that some of the participants had here, but me first. You mentioned biodiverse pastures, and unfortunately, a lot of the pastures that we have in this country, and unfortunately, around the world are monocultures, pastures that have been planted to one species of grass. In the United States, the eastern U.S. is largely monoculture tall fescue. In the southern United States, it's monoculture Bermuda grass. How do these data change when you go to a monoculture pasture system? And I guess, what are the advantages of making our pastures more and more diverse? We've talked with Christine Jones about diversity, how plant diversity affects the soil microbiome. How does increased plant diversity or less plant diversity affect what you've shown here?
Yeah, I mean, it's like if one takes nothing away other than diversity is key. That's also what we're finding. Indeed, researchers in other fields are finding plant diversity is key for soil health, for even the health of the plants themselves, right? And we're finding the same thing in meat too. Plant diversity seems to be key in accumulating a lot of these phytochemicals. The farmers that have more biodiversity, they typically have the most favorable omega 6 to 3 ratio. So we see this trickle down effect, like you described, Dale, what others are finding in the soil. We see that trickling down to the animal too. Whereas there's a clear distinction between a monoculture or a polyculture in terms of animal health and nutrient density.
Okay. We have a number of questions from our participants here. One is about sedentary lifestyle of the animals. We know that has an effect on sedentary lifestyle, has an effect on human health. Feedlot animals lead a more sedentary lifestyle than grazing animals because they're not walking. Could that have an effect on these animals?
Absolutely. Yeah. I absolutely think that's the case. And some of these TCA cycle metabolites, the mitochondrial metabolites that I showed that were higher in the grass-fed animals, I don't think that has anything to do with the fact that they're eating grass. I think it has to do with the fact that they are on pasture and are able to walk more than a feedlot animal. So you're absolutely right about that. And we are hopefully starting to tease out some of these things over the next few years where we are indeed starting to look at that. Like if you give a lot more space to an animal, even in a feedlot versus less, does the animal get healthier? Or even on pasture, if you restrict it more than versus, you know, having a more room on pasture, we're trying to tease out the effects of physical activity from diet. But many of the things that I presented here, specifically regarding glucose metabolic health and the mitochondrial health, yeah, I think those are absolutely related to activity levels.
Well, along those same lines, I know that animals that undergo a very high level of stress just right prior to slaughter have, I mean, there is a huge difference in carcass quality if animals experience stress and we have dark cutters. Even the color of the meat changes if animals are highly stressed right prior to slaughter. And I suspect if animals have a stressful environment for 60 days prior to slaughter, that probably also affects meat quality.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think that's safe to say. Yeah, that would be my hypothesis too.
A couple other questions that are kind of similar. One is the nutrient density of plants grown hydroponically with plants grown in soil. And then another one about hydroponically grown greens, like sprouted barley grain. I guess they call them fodder systems.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate anything on that?
Good question. It's a very good question because I have the same questions and we are studying these questions now. So my hypothesis would be, and from some of our initial work, fodder, fresh greens that are sprouted greens and then fed to animals are probably more phytochemically rich than hay, just because it's fresher, right? So that's maybe a thing of like during winter feeding. The other question was hydroponically grown produce versus soil. There is some, again, we're doing more profiling on that, so I'm stay tuned. But if we look at the broader literature, there is some suggestion that there are differences between soil grown versus hydroponically grown. But again, what a lot of these other studies didn't tease out is that, was the soil conventionally managed, or was it, you know, no-till, or was it, you know, in a biodiverse system, or regenerative, as many farmers would call it? Those are some of the differences that we do not know why, if there are differences between hydroponics. So I don't rule out that we can do hydroponics really well or really bad, and the same as with the soil ground systems. So that is something, that is of interest to me, but I don't know the answer yet.
Another question. Question was Roundup Ready corn, genetically modified to resist glyphosate. Those phytochemicals are, the shikimate pathway, affecting micronutrient availability, phytochemical availability. If animals were fed Roundup Ready corn, is that different than non-GMO corn?
Good question. I'm not 100% sure at this point if it is different. We have been doing, what I can tell you though is that there's difference in feedlots. Absolutely. We have we just recently finished, and by finished I mean I've worked on this yesterday. So omega 6 to 3 ratios, and we've profiled, I think it's like 50, 60 farms, several feedlots. And what we're seeing is that the sort of the smaller, I call them artisanal feedlots, they have typically that feed a little less corn, or maybe not Roundup Ready. They have a more favorable omega 6 to 3 profile. We will have phytochemical data on that in the future too. So I'm not 100% sure. But our initial findings suggest that the omega 63 profile is better in some of those feedlots that and these are people that have grow their own corn and then feed it to an animal in a smaller feedlot system, for instance, that typically do not use some of these heavier processes or use a Roundup Ready corn. So it could be that that's the case.
Okay. Going down here, we have a number of questions. I'm trying to get through them all in the most time sensitive way. One is also soy and grain finished animals. Can you distinguish between had a question about ALA and I think you had linoleic acid, and they're asking about linoleic acid. Can you address the difference between those two and soy and seed oil versus pasture on those two?
Yeah. So omega-6, if you look at the omega-6 profile, indeed what the person is referring to, whereas ALA is an omega-3 that's found in forages, and we found that to be tenfold higher in the grass-fed animals, right? And the N6 PUFA is typically higher in grain-fed animals. We find that to be much higher. So because, and it makes sense because they're fed more grains. We haven't tease out those differences yet per se, but my guess would be that feeding corn versus soy contains a little bit more of the omega-3 fatty acids too, ALA. So that if you feed corn, that maybe you have a little bit more, a better omega-6 to 3 ratio when you're fed soy versus corn. So that would be my educated guess based on and informed by some of the data that we have too, where some producers feed soy hulls and some are but this is on pasture. So again, complicates things a little bit where people are feeding soy holes on pasture, but so the animal also consumes still forage, right? Versus maybe in the feedlot where corn is very common.
Yeah, I think that the origin of the question was linoleic versus linolenic acid. Yeah, okay, so linoleic is higher in soy and linolenic is higher in grass finished.
Yes, correct? That is correct. That is correct. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Thanks for clarifying.
Okay. Had a question here. What's the best way to measure pasture quality? Is a bricks meter a good way to measure pasture quality?
Yeah. I must say I'm not an agronomist, so I defer to my agronomy colleagues on that. But I do know a lot of pasture-based farmers that we work with use a bricks meter, and so that is typically a good way of measuring it. But honestly, you can, you know, that is a good way, but I'd say just rely on observation too. You could probably tell if your forages are good quality, if they are diverse, if they are, you know, luscious and dense vegetation, then you're likely going to have phytochemical riches in there too. So data is important, but I would also rely on farmer observation, because I must admit a lot of the things that we're doing in our lab, we are sort of verifying farmer observations too. And we're seeing that in our data too, whereas usually the farmer is sort of clued in on that, but doesn't have the data behind it. So, but a bricks meter could be a case. And yeah, we do more sophisticated analysis. We run phytochemicals on the forage to see what's actually in the forage, and that we could tell you too, but we realize that's not something that you do every week.
Had a comment on here, and I'll give my own personal
sure.
expression. Personal opinion. The comment was, I fully support nutrient density, but all of my neighboring cattle farmers believe nobody wants, in quotations, nasty tasting meat, no matter how healthy it might be. How do I respond to this attitude? My personal opinion is that the best steak I ever had in my life was grass finished, and the worst steak I ever had in my life was grass finished. Corn finished is consistent. It's pretty much the same. There's a very broad spectrum of quality, and grass finishing is both a science and an art. And there are people who do it very well and people who do it very poorly. Unfortunately, most people are doing it poorly. They just leave, you know, what is referred to as grass finished is probably a crippled cow that got slaughtered because they had no other option for it. But grass finished meat done well is the best eating experience you'll ever have. That's my own personal opinion.
Yeah.
And we need more people doing it well.
Yeah. And yeah, from a data standpoint, I can tell you is that, yes, we see less variation amongst feedlot finished beef in terms of the nutrients, but there's a huge variation in grass finished. We even have some data on the omega 6 to 3 profiles where some farms are like close to 1:1, 1.5:1. And then we have some grass finished producers that are 20:1. So they have lots of omega 6s in it, which assuming the data doesn't lie, they are definitely feeding something that's very high in omega 6s. And I doubt whether it's grass. So that's also one of the things. And of course, you know, overgrazed monocultures versus a biodiverse pasture, day and night difference in phytochemical profiles too. So, and these phytochemicals, I've talked about this in the terms of health, right? But these phytochemicals are also what give flavor to it. And these phytochemicals, they've predominantly been studied in cheese, the French and the Italians, and they've provided a lot of our inspiration for the work that we're doing now in meat, in North American ruminants. But they were studying that from how do we get the flavor of our cheeses optimized by providing different forages to our animals or have them graze different pastures, different mountain pastures, so that we get these unique flavors in cheese. So that's something to realize too, that those phytochemicals, yes, I look at this from a nutrition human health standpoint, but there are also flavor profiles or flavor compounds.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, people that are used to grass-finished beef that come from, say, Argentina, where grass-finished beef is the norm, and come to the United States, say our meat has no flavor. It's very bland and tasteless. And so, yeah, you can get a steak that actually tastes like a steak. And like I said, the best I ever had. And it is an art. It takes more knowledge. Grass finishing beef is a knowledge driven industry, I believe.
Yeah.
And it's not nearly as simple as just rolling out corn and letting the cattle eat. So, but the potential for a much better flavor is definitely there. Other questions, any of the farms you're studying, were they using holistic management, adaptive managed paddock grazing, or
all of those? Definitely most of the farms that we studied here use some sort of adaptive grazing, indeed, leaving plenty of forage on the pasture before moving to the next pasture, long resting cycles. Of course, you know, there's a variation between farmers, but I'd say certainly the ones that we're working with have some of the better practices, and you see that in the meat for sure. Yeah, you can see that they have these omega 6 to 3 ratios that are below 2, so most of those, and have phytochemical richness. So most of them that we work with are indeed doing that.
Okay, so probably one more. We're over time, but this is really good. So I'm okay with going over time a little bit here, but I want to be sensitive to your time. What? How is this information getting out? Are people becoming more and more aware of this? And
I hope so. I mean, one of the ways to get this information out is doing webinars like this. But yes, we are indeed, of course, publishing this data. We are working with groups such as Understanding Ag, or with university extension programs, with the BioNutrient Institute. We have a big project going on with them where we are looking at goals to profile 250 farms, anything from grass-fed to grain-fed and anything in between. One of the things, for instance, I'm very interested in is that maybe from this presentation, it looks like I'm against grain finishing, but I'm not at all. I think there's definitely a role for feeding some grains and upcycling byproducts to animals. I think it's a great way of doing that. But sometimes we do these extremes, right? Where then we're thinking like, oh, let's put animals in confinement and push them up to 80% grains. We take something that's good and we kind of take it to the extreme. So I'm interested also studying like free choice grain on pasture or other byproducts, right? Which could be a great way of relieving some of the grazing pressure. So it's really, and what we're seeing in definitely a feedlot isn't a feedlot isn't a feedlot. We see this range in practices and nutritional quality too. So we are hoping to figure that out and really getting a deeper insight in sort of this spectrum. Because my guess is it will fall on this spectrum. As you mentioned, Dale, you have had the best steak and the worst grass-fed steak, right? And it wouldn't surprise me if some of these grass-fed steaks might be, you know, not really on the other end of the spectrum, right?
So I guess another question is that, sure, I talk to a lot of people who are say vegans, vegetarians, who refuse to eat meat because, you know, they say, well, meat is bad for you. I mean, what we've shown here is that, you know, grass finished meat is apparently by most measures better than grain finished meat.
On paper, yes.
Can you compare meat nutritionally to meat alternatives nutritionally?
We've done that. Google, it's a paper in Scientific Reports. If you Google grass-fed meat, I think we can link it in the show notes potentially, but it's a paper we published in Scientific Reports. We profiled grass-fed beef, the same grass-fed beef as we did here from Alder Spring Ranch, and we compared it to a popular plant-based meat alternative. And as you can imagine, the differences are even more dramatic than grass-fed and grain-fed because it's a completely different starting material, right? The burger that we tested was made from soy, using isolated soy and sunflower oil, coconut oil, heme iron, and things like that. So 90% difference in metabolite abundance is what we found there.
Wow.
The short end of it is that we found beneficial compounds in the grass-fed meat. We found some unique phenolic metabolites and beneficial compounds in the plant-based meat. And, you know, if someone doesn't want to eat meat for ethical reasons or things like that, I'm totally supportive of that. That's, you know, one should have that choice. But it is important to note that a plant-based meat alternative is not a one-to-one nutritional replacement for grass-fed meat once you go beyond protein. Not to say that, they're unhealthy or anything like that. Randomized controlled trials suggest that you can eat plant-based meat alternatives and they're compatible with good health. Various randomized controlled trials would suggest that you can eat even grain-fed beef if you eat it as part of a high-quality diet, right? Eating red meat, it's not to go too far into that, but a lot of studies would suggest that eating red meat as part of the standard American diet is associated with increased risk of heart disease, cancer, but it oftentimes is also what you consume with the red meat, right? A lot of ultra-processed foods, people that eat a lot of ultra-processed foods also tend to be high meat consumers. So, but then when people consume red meat as part of a Mediterranean diet or a DASH diet or some other whole foods-based diet, you see that these associations with metabolic disease oftentimes become neutral, suggesting that overall diet quality in which you consume individual foods such as red meat are far more important. And it also suggests that once you account for some of those, you know, low fruit and vegetable intake, high ultra-processed food intake, once you account for that, then you see that moderate amounts of red meat appear to be compatible with good health. And there was even a study that came out recently in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition from the Women's Health Initiative that suggested that it wasn't the red meat per se, it was what you ate with red meat. And I think more studies are starting to tease that out. And of course, there's a dose response and, you know, it's how much red meat do you eat and things like that. But I would say that as part of consuming a whole foods diet, red meat is likely compatible with good health.
Yeah, I think I would agree from what I've read. It's not the presence of red meat, it's the absence of fruits and vegetables.
Yeah,
poor diet. In the typical American
diet.
Poor diet quality. The red meat is fine. It's not the burger. It's the bun and the French fries fried in seed oil that always seem to go with
it. Or, you know, and of course, I mean, it becomes nuanced there, Dale, quickly, because, you know, there could be a case where if you consume very high amounts, that it may become problematic. If you grill all your meats, you know, maybe that's something problematic, right? So that's those are some of those the nuances that we're not just us, but many groups are trying to tease out. Yeah.
Well, we should probably, and we have a question here from Sarah Keough. And so I need to include this before we wrap up. Can you share a little bit about what you're measuring in your human subjects in your upcoming study?
Yeah, so we are measuring inflammation in those people and oxidative stress. We're doing similar metabolomics on the plasma samples of humans as we've done on the meat. So we can see this direct comparison between, you know, the old statement, you are what you eat. It's at least to an extent true. So can we pick up these compounds in the meat and from the meat or the other foods into the humans? So we're studying inflammation. We're studying lipoprotein profiles. So it'd be cholesterol, triglycerides. We're studying glucose metabolic health. We're studying oxidative stress. We're also studying the gut microbiome in people, and then we're also taking urine samples and studying urinary outcomes, because a lot of these phytochemicals you can measure in the urine, and even an indicator of the phytochemical richness that you had in your body that you have had access to. So yeah, we're trying to study as much as we reasonably can, and looking at biomarkers of various metabolic diseases or health states that, you know, could potentially predict. If you do that for 20 years, then, you know, you might have a different disease outcome.
Fascinating. Well, I've spent a good chunk of my adult life trying to design better pastures. And I was always trying to make the pastures more productive, to produce more beef per acre, more milk per acre, more lamb per acre, whatever. And now I think it's just fascinating and exciting that I can make, potentially have information to make pastures better for human health. And I'm just tremendously excited. Very, very appreciative of you coming on. Thank you so much. Great information, and looking forward to continuing the conversation in the future. So thank you everybody for watching. Sorry, we just couldn't get to all the questions in the time we have allotted, but you can feel free to email any further questions into Noah at Green Cover Seed, and we'll try to get those questions answered for you. Noah, Sophie, do you have anything to add before we wrap up?
Just wanted to say thank you for everyone for coming on, and thank you, Stephan. This was a great first webinar to kick off this series.
Thank you so much for having me. And if anyone has any further questions, just find me on Google or Twitter or something. Send me a direct message or email me on stefan.vanvliet@usu.edu. And I'm happy to answer any questions insofar I can. So
thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Please join us next week. Sophie, you want to announce next week?
Yeah. So next week, we are going to have Dr. Annabelle Ford come on to speak about Maya Milpa and the relevance of ancient agricultural techniques in today's agriculture. That is going to be at the same time next week. And we've already got, I believe, 3 other webinars lined up. So we'll be sending out information for those and announcing our new webinars as they come out. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.